Alright, so Garrett, it's great to see you again. I haven't seen you in a while.
And cheers, congratulations on your master's.
Thank you. So where are you at with the expansion of the brewery? You've gotten a lot done over the past 2 years. Like, where are you at? Like, what's gone on since yet so far?
It's pretty incredible. I mean, the brewery is literally, physically, four times the size that it was a short time ago. The crew is growing very quickly. So right now, I'm hiring two new brewers and one new cellarman, et cetera, et cetera. And we're moving in the direction of having, a brewing operation that's going 24 hours a day. And we've been growing at like 35% a year. And things are going really well. But, the current level of expansion has allowed us to put Sriracha Ace out as one of our regular beers, now available. This year we're going to have quite a bit more Black Ops than we had last year. Still going to be relatively rare, but there'll be at least a little bit more. We're able to expand the Brewmaster's Reserve beers into states where we couldn't get it before. And so, we're just able to do a lot more of the stuff, that we've wanted to do, because it's been so frustrating over the years being hemmed in, in those fall walls. So the next phase is we add another 8 200 barrel tanks.
Wow.
And that brings the level of this brewery up to about 95,000 barrels. So we'll be cooking with gas by then.
All right, so how has this expansion affected your overall mission? Because now that you can do more, how does this help you expand your mission to keep spreading good beer?
Right now, I'm kind of working on the barrel program. I would like to have 500, 600 barrels with stuff aging in it. We have any number of special projects, that are always going on. But a lot of them are small batch things. They're so small, we can't even really sell them. We bring them to beer dinners and special events and things like that, but we don't get an opportunity to put them on shelves. This is really now an opportunity where we can say, okay, if we can produce a couple of thousand cases of something, enough for everybody to be able to get, or most people to be able to get a bottle who want one, then that takes us to a different level. So, I'm looking at, okay, how do we go about expanding that program? Where do we keep the barrels? Because they take up a lot of space. We can't keep them right at the brewery. But probably 5 miles down the road at our distributor, we have enough space that we can do that. This year, we're actually aging some Black Ops there. So, I think there's going to be a lot of opportunities for us to really bring all these things to fruition in the future.
That's great. I mean, one side of you as a person that some craft beer fans don't know is like you travel a lot. Like, you really spread the gospel of food and beer all over the world. So can you just tell us, for my viewers, a little bit about what you do throughout the year beyond just being like the brewmaster of Brooklyn?
Well, it's funny. There are a lot of people who think that I travel all the time. I'm actually on the road about 20% of the time, which is, not small. It's a lot. I was probably in four or five countries just in April and May. But I think it's great. As craft brewing spreads worldwide, the United States really is the focal point, for the craft beer experience worldwide, for styles, for inspiration, for creativity. And so, I've had the opportunity, for example, to go to Germany, and bring beer to Germany, bring beer to places like Belgium, and it's not like taking sand to the beach, because we really do have something different, to offer. Doing collaborations with guys like, Carlsberg over in Sweden, where last year we sent 150 bourbon barrels over. We barrel-aged the 175th anniversary of Carnegie Porter. And I think that's only the beginning. There's a lot of cool stuff to be done, not just here, but in other countries. I mean, now we're in 17 countries.
Wow.
What's great is that the name Brooklyn now around the world is really cool, where when we started 15, 20 years ago, it was not cool at all. It was Brooklyn, and people were like, oh man, you named something Brooklyn? That's terrible. Now Brooklyn is considered like, a real cultural capital, we end up doing things like music festivals, Brooklyn Music Festival in Sweden, food festivals, things like that. So, I think that there's really not a limit, to the stuff we're going to be able to do.
I mean, we've seen that, even though some breweries, some countries like England and Belgium and Germany that we've, as American brewers, have taken influence from, now, like, their scenes are also affected by macro lagers, and they're looking to America to reinvigorate their beer tradition that's been around for thousands of years. So, like, what have you seen on your travels based on that?
Well, I find it, you know, fascinating just being here that, you know, take IPA. IPA is originally British style, came to the United States, was semi-popular in the 1800s, died out in the United States and England, and then we started making it in the 80s. The British started to notice the IPAs we make, and they started making our version of their beer style, and then they sell it back to us. You know, so you have an evolution of all these British breweries who are brewing American-style IPA and sending it back to the United States, you know, and it's like a ping-pong ball of culture. But it, you know, it really is the same way that it's always been with food. You know, food has traveled around the world, and so a French chef in New York can take on a Chinese or Japanese influence. You know, a Korean chef, you know, might use a French influence. And it's natural for these things to travel. And you go to Brazil, you go to Japan, you go anywhere in the world, you're going to see the American influence there. And I'm kind of proud of that, you know, because back in the day, you know, people would, they felt sorry for you. You said you were an American brewer, and they were like, oh yeah, we've had your American beer. It's horrible. And now people know that, you know, we can do some pretty good stuff.
Yeah, so you were talking a little bit about now you're letting your brewers, like, really brew their own test batches. Can you tell a little bit about that series that you're doing?
Well, we call it the Worshipful Company of Brewers, which is the name of the old London Brewers Guild. And it's an opportunity for each of these guys, you know, after these many years that I've been doing all the recipes. Not that I haven't taken, you know, ideas from some of the other guys, and I've always wanted that to do that, but everybody's very busy. It's very hard to have the time to think creatively when you're working, you know, physically. By focusing their minds on their own beer and their own launch party and their own name and whatever else, everybody's gotten really excited. They're like, oh, then they get a little bit competitive between each other, you know, so they're like, okay, I got my shot right now to brew something that has nothing. I've had no input whatsoever into any of them. All I'm doing is helping them source ingredients. Like, you need rose hips, I'll help you find some rose hips. You need this hot variety, I'll help you find that. Otherwise, unless they ask, you know, those recipes are 100% them. You know, I think it's great.
I mean, following up with that, like, with a lot of your Brewmaster's Reserve Series beers, you've had some really outlandish, like, ingredients that no one would ever think of putting in here. Like, you made the Manhattan Project to go after the cocktail. How do you source all these amazing ingredients?
Well, you know, you have to do a lot of research. I mean, when we did the concoction last year based on the cocktail, the penicillin, you know, which is scotch, ginger, honey, and lemon, we had never used peat smoke malt or lemon juice. We did use a lot of honey already. Ginger, we didn't know anything about ginger. I mean, we knew it for cooking at home, but we had to do a whole bunch of little tests with ginger to see, like, when you infuse ginger into a beer, what happens? So, you know, all of this is like a learning process. You know, sometimes we do stuff with ingredients that we know, sometimes ingredients we don't know. Our next beer that's coming out, Fiat Lux, has lime, you know, has lime peel in it. Now, we've used, you know, two different types of orange peel, lemon peel, etc. Lime peel is really different. Lime peel has a lot of bitterness to it. You know, that's why you see, like, orange bitters, lime bitters, you know, etc. So we were surprised by the level of bitterness in lime peel, and we had to, like, okay, work on this, blend it, you know, etc. to get to the level that we want. But that's how you learn new things.
Right. I mean, one question I have for you is that now that you're expanding, like, how does the bigger, you know, capacity, how is it affecting your year-round line? Like, you know, you contract grew a little upstate,
yeah,
but now you have more room here. How does like the new more space affect, like, the bottling and whole process and affects your year-round line?
What's happening is that both these things are moving together. You know, the side that we do up in Utica is growing. What we're doing, you know, in Brooklyn is exploding. So, you know, they're both growing, and I think that we will, and we have, taken some things that we used to brew upstate back in-house, you know, for the time being. But longer term, those things might move back upstate, and then we may concentrate in Brooklyn on things where they're really specialized you know, stuff that involves wild yeast, barrel age, you know, heavy dry hopping, things like that, that aren't as easy to do, you know, up there. Things that really require us to be 100% hands on with it every day. Up in Utica, you know, we're able to do, what we do with Brooklyn Lager and have for 20 years, but new stuff, you got to keep working.
I'm going to do one last question is that, you know, like, have you ever thought of, like, brewing, like, you have the East India IPA, but have you ever thought of brewing, like the American IPA and double IPA? Like, have you ever thought of taking your Blast or another IPA and really making it more widely available in bottles?
We are definitely thinking about that. We're trying to figure out how to do it best, you know, how to get it on the shelf, tasting the way that we want to. But it's definitely something that we're working on. We're working on expanding, our relationships with farmers, hop farmers in particular, so we can get the quality of hops that we need to produce, more of these beers. As you know, a lot of the hotter hops are really in a very high demand, very hard to get. So it's not just a matter of turning on a switch. We have to build these relationships, figure out what we want, figure out how to get into the bottle, tasting the way that people expect it to taste. And it gets pretty technical. It's a challenge, but it's good. You will see this in the future.
I know you're up for the challenge, so again, good luck.
We'll do our best as always.
And we'll be in touch.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers.